Welcome back, everyone. Family Guy, let's go. Seth MacFarlane has done a bunch of good stuff for science. We'll explain some of that whilst we watch some Family Guy.
If I remember correctly, this is the physics department.
That explains all the gravity.
Terrible. Terrible joke.
Let's see. I need plutonium for the time machine. But how do I get past those guards? Oh, wait, that's right. I'm in England. I can just walk past them holding a cup of tea. Morning.
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 So plutonium doesn't actually glow green like that. Neither does uranium. It's a bit of a myth. It's in The Simpsons as well, but yeah, there's no glowing like that. And it's actually completely safe to touch in its solid form. You can touch it and there's no hazard. But I wouldn't eat it because a gram of uranium has about 20 billion calories. You got to stay fit, guys, especially if you're in a lockdown. That's a lot of calories. I'm only kidding. I mean a different calorie. So there's two different meanings of calories here, but you probably still shouldn't eat it.
I'm about to show you something that's going to blow your mind. Do you know what the Big Bang Theory is?
Yeah, the theory that the universe started with a massive outward explosion from a singularity of infinite mass and infinite density.
Check out the big brain on Brian. Good. Now take a look.
So that's, he just said a bunch of things that are wrong. So if you think the Big Bang was the beginning of the universe, well, you're about 40 years out of date. So let me explain. But firstly, he said about three things that are wrong. He said the Big Bang Theory is an explosion. It's not an explosion. He said the universe started from a hot, dense singularity. No, we don't actually know how the universe started. And we don't know if it started from a singularity. So something actually came, and we know this, before the Big Bang, and we call that inflation. So this comes from a theory called cosmic inflation. We can't extrapolate the hot Big Bang back to a singularity. We only can to the end and final stages of the inflationary period that preceded it. We can't state with any confidence what caused this inflationary period or what happened before the very final stages of inflation. So to put that in scale, the universe during this inflationary period grew by a factor of about 10 to the 26. And since the Big Bang to now, the universe has only grown by a factor of about 10 to the 26. But in the inflationary period happened in the time of a fraction of a second. We have no idea what caused this inflationary state. The universe might have been in this inflationary state forever. The universe might even be cyclical in nature.
Take a look. The universe's cosmic background radiation, a kind of echo of the Big Bang, precisely matches the energy spectrum of my return pad.
What does that mean?
So a cool little fact about the CMB radiation is that, you know, old televisions, when you turn them on and you see the static, about 1% of that static is radiation coming from the Big Bang. And you actually see the CMB from every direction that you look.
Evidence indicates that Ireland was a much different place before the discovery of alcohol. Most experts believe it was something like this.
Gentlemen, today we, Ireland's top scientists, have found a way to convert our entire population to pure energy.
Oh, it's a glorious day.
Absolutely. Hey, Michael McLeod's just invented a new kind of beverage in his basement.
Whiskey.
Yeah. Alcohol and science don't mix very well. It's my boy Neil.
Billions of years to reach the Earth. Hamburger.
What? I don't get the joke at the end. Can someone explain to me in the comments what that hamburger joke was?
I think they're over there between the rain ponchos and the cap guns and just below the balsa wood gliders and the net bag of flip-flops and a beach pail.
Did you know that in Australia we actually call flip-flops thongs? The cap gun. I can't remember how old I was. No, I'm not going to talk about thongs. And I got a cap gun and like those cap things for Christmas. And I was sitting at the dinner table for Christmas, just eating my food. And then I noticed there was a bunch of smoke around. And then I looked down and I was literally on fire. My leg was on fire. Somehow the caps exploded, caught on fire. And next thing I jump up, jump over the couch. I'm still on fire. Rip off my pants, and yeah. So it melted a bunch of skin on my leg. Don't put caps in your pockets, guys. Worst Christmas ever.
One poop removal.
Wow, did I just go poop?
You sure did, all digital.
Where does it go?
It gets beamed to another dimension.
The possibilities, endless.
Some people say we're just a computer simulation run by a higher species. Is that true?
It is.
Want to trade guys for a little while? Oh, never mind. I'll stick with this pile of crap I already have.
Ah, the old computer simulation hypothesis. So I'm sure most of you have come across this one by now. There's a lot of people out there that confuse this simulation hypothesis with the holographic principle. Now, if you've never heard of the holographic principle, it is pretty cool, and it kind of suggests that our universe is a hologram. So we currently think that space has three spatial dimensions, but this holographic principle suggests on a more fundamental level, there's really only two dimensions, and that everything we see going on around us in three dimensions is actually happening in a two-dimensional space. And to be honest, this kind of sounds more far-fetched than this simulation stuff. You know, we have simulations already on our computers and we can program stuff. And if you assume that the brain can be simulated, well then why couldn't you imagine that you could create a simulation on your computer in the future when we can simulate brains and you put some conscious entities in there and then there you go, you've got a simulated universe. There's absolutely no reason why that couldn't happen and happen pretty soon, in my opinion. But back to this holographic principle, this is actually a thing that's taken very seriously in physics because there's some kind of indirect evidence. I wouldn't say there is evidence, but the reason why physicists are very excited about this holographic principle is that we've struggled for a long time to bring together quantum mechanics and general relativity. It just doesn't seem to want to play ball. But this holographic principle, if everything's really just a two-dimensional plane, everything's in this two-dimensional universe, well, they actually might fit together. And so people are very excited about it. There's math behind it. People are looking for some experiments. It's exciting times. Next time something even remotely relevant, I'll dive into it because you know it doesn't take me much to go on a tangent. Before we get back into watching Family Guy, I've got two questions for you. And I want to know what you guys think. So leave a comment down under if you can answer any of them. Have a crack. So one, do we live in a simulation? Let me know down under. Two, can we simulate consciousness? I think they're pretty interesting and fun things to think about, so give it a crack.
Now return to Carl Sagan's Cosmos.
No way.
Rednecks. I'm Carl Sagan.
My favorite show ever.
Just how old is our planet? Hundreds and hundreds of years old. Scientists have determined that the universe was created by God. Big Bang. If you look at the bones of a Jesusnosaurus Rex, it's clear by the use of carbon dating that Mountain Dew is the best soda ever made.
So Carl Sagan is actually a hero of mine. Absolutely love him. I've got like all of his books. If you haven't seen that and you're into science, you've got to check it out. You're missing out. He's such a beautiful human. And with the current state of the world with science and all the things happening in Afghanistan, I think the world could really do with some more Carl Sagan right about now. We actually have a different word for redneck in Australia. We have what's called an Australian bogan. Did you know that Seth MacFarlane was such a massive fan of the original Cosmos and Carl Sagan? He actually helped get the new version of Cosmos made. The season 2 with Neil deGrasse Tyson and the more recent season. He was actually the producer. He put a lot of money into those projects and basically got it to what it was. So what a legend. He's done a lot for science.
Okay, kids, now this is the Quahog Museum of Science, a magical place. That sucks.
Why do science museums always suck? There is way too much stuff like this in the world, and it's exactly why I'm making videos like this, because that stuff puts everyone off. Science is freaking cool. I'm on a mission down here, guys. I want to make science cool. Once we can get young kids looking up to scientists, the way they look up to basketball players, the way they look up to YouTubers, and this could be the key, our civilization will take the next step, and the possibilities are endless. It'll be, what an exciting future that we will have if we can do this. I know it's possible. Help me get the word out there and help me change the game. We actually first discovered this stuff whilst we were making bombs in the 40s, and we kept it hidden from the world for a few years because people were worried it was going to be used for a bomb. It was used for a bomb, and then we realized we can do some pretty cool stuff with it. We actually use this stuff to power deep space probes in something called a radioisotope thermoelectric generator. America is actually running out of this stuff because they don't make it anymore. And obviously, we want it to power our deep space probes. So they're buying it off Russia currently. Some people have suggested we can just get it out of old nuclear bombs, but I don't know about that. It's powering one of my favorite space probes, probably my favorite, Voyager 1, which is sailing out there. And it's recently left our solar system, the first craft ever to do so. And in about 16,000 years, it's going to fly by Proxima Centauri, the nearest star, and it's going to run out of power at about, I think it's 2025, when we'll lose contact with it, because this generator using this plutonium stuff is going to shut down, and that could be it. And a fun little fact about Voyager 1, it's got this thing called the Golden Record on it, and Carl Sagan, who we've talked about in this video, actually created this, and he decided what would be put on it. So there's a bunch of music, there's a bunch of things on it about humanity and where you can find us. And at the time, people were a bit worried, like, you know, should we really be announcing our position in the universe? So this thing out there floating through the universe is going to outlive our species, most likely. And so all this stuff, if it's picked up by an alien civilization one day, they'll know something of us. And it's got this beautiful quote on it, and it says, "To the makers of music, all worlds, all times." When this spacecraft was out beyond Neptune on Valentine's Day 1990, Carl suggested that we turn the probe around and take a picture of Earth, take a picture of home one final time. And so it did so, and it produced this image. And you can clearly see almost a single pixel. You can see the Earth like in a beam of light. And as Carl put it, suspended in a sunbeam, and he wrote this beautiful book called Pale Blue Dot, which was inspired by this single picture. Highly suggest you go and check it out.